I'm 20 minutes out of delay, so how much time do I have? 1 hour you can give me. Okay, that's great. Thank you. Thank you very much. So sorry for this problem at ETH. So okay. So let me start. So let me first recall that so the objects under study are real projective manifold. So a real projective manifold is the vanishing locus of a system of polynomial equations with real coefficients in a complex projective space. So I guess you all know this. So let me fix some notation. So I denote by X the whole set of complex points of the manifold, so the whole vanishing locus of the polynomial in the complex projective space. I denote by Rx the real locus of the manifold, that is the vanishing set in the real projective space. And I denote by Cx the involution, anti-holomorphic involution on this manifold, which is the restriction of the complex conjugation of the ambient complex projective space. So of course, in this complex projective space, there is this complex conjugation, which complex conjugates all coordinates of this projective space. And since this polynomial have real coefficients, this complex conjugation restricts as an anti-holomorphic involution on this manifold. So let me also comment that we usually do not care a specific embedding of this manifold in the complex projective space, and we rather consider these real projective manifold abstractly as the pair made of this manifold X, complex projective manifold X, together with this anti-holomorphic involution Cx. And the real locus is just the fixed point set of this involution Cx. So, for example, in dimension 1, this manifold X complex manifold is just a Riemann, compact Riemann surface together with this anti-holomorphic involution Cx. And the real locus is just a real manifold of dimension 1 and compact. So it is just a union of some disjoint union of circles. And the number of connected components, which I denote by B0 of Rx, is bounded from above by the genus plus 1. This is an old theorem of Felix Klein in 1876. So I can add, moreover, to this theorem that all values between 0 and this genus plus 1 can be achieved. There is such a real projective curve with this number of real connected components. And also, for example, in genus 0, you see that there are actually two real curves up to isomorphism. So one is just the real projective line or real conic ellipsis, for which the real locus is just made of one circle. It's isomorphic to RP1. But there is also the real imaginary conic of equation x squared plus y squared equals minus 1, for which the real locus is empty. And by definition, when this maximal bound allowed by Klein's theorem is achieved, that is, curve for which the number of B0 of Rx exactly equals genus plus 1, these curves are called maximal. These are maximal curves. So these are the curves basically under study for today. Well, they were involved in Hilbert 16's problem. So these are quite famous curves and quite studied in real algebraic geometry. So what I want to discuss is, in a sense, the size occupied by these real maximal curves. So let me make this precise. So first of all, now I'm working with real projective surfaces, so all the talk will be in dimension 2. So let X be a smooth real projective surface. And now consider on this a real ample line bundle. This is a ample line bundle over the complex manifold surface X, but also which come with this real structure, this anti-holomorphic involution, which commutes with the one on the basis. So this is an ample line bundle defined over the real. Now for every positive degree D, I denote by RLD the complete linear system of divisor associated to this. So what does this mean? So I have this degree D, I can take the tensor power of L to the D. So I can consider all tensor power of my ample line bundle, LD. And then I denote by H0 of X, LD, the vector space of holomorphic sections of this bundle. And I can take the projective space out of this vector space of holomorphic section. This is the complete linear system of divisor, but I take the real part, which means rather the projective space out of the sections which are Z2 equivalent for the involution CX and CL, the real sections. So this is a real projective space. And of course, it encodes divisor, real divisor, linearly equivalent to LD. But in this dimension, real divisors are just curves, of course. So in this real projective space, I see also an hypersurface, which is the discriminant locus, which is just the hypersurface made of singular divisors. And I will just remove this singular divisor, which are of codimension one, and just consider smooth ones. So for every such curve C in this linear system, away from this discriminant, the curve is smooth. And let me recall that its genus is just given by adjunction formula. By this formula, it's 1 half of D square L square minus D times the first chain class of X against L plus 2. And you should notice that this genus grows quadratically with respect to the degree. So if I increase D, this genus has a quadratic growth. Now, what is the picture? So I have this, in this real projective space, I have this hypersurface, discriminant hypersurface, which is of codimension 1. So over the complex number, it would be of complex codimension 1, which would imply that the complement is just connected. But over the real number, the situation is drastically different. So it is of real codimension 1, and the complement of the discriminant is made actually of an incredible number of connected components. So it's more than an exponentially huge number of connected components. So there is a quite primitive way to distinguish this component is by this function B0. It's a topological function which is locally constant. It just associates to every smooth curve the number of connected components of its real locus. So that is just a little bit of topology. It's of course locally constant, so constant on every connected component away from the discriminant. Okay. So from Klein's theorem, we know that this function only takes value between 0 and genus plus 1. So, once more, our aim is to understand the size of maximal curves. So I denote by MD the open subset of smooth maximal curves in RLD. So this is the union of all connected components of the complement of the discriminant, which corresponds to maximal curves, curve for which this number of real connected components is genus plus 1, the maximal allowed. And more generally, for every positive constant A, I can denote by MDA the set of such smooth curves such that the number of real components is not maximal, but which is very large. So it differs from the maximal number G plus 1 by just a linear term with slope A. So remember that the genus grows quadratically. So, and now I just remove A times D, so this is linear with respect to D, since I fixed once for all A. So this set of curves contains the set MD of maximal curves. So it's just bigger, bigger sets. So our main theorem joint work with Damien Gaillet. So it was written on the first page. So all this is a joint work with Damien Gaillet, who is also from Lyon. So our main theorem is that there exists constants C1 and C2, such that for every degree D, the volume of this open set MAD is bounded from above by C1 exponential minus C2D. So this means this open set has a volume which exponentially decreases as D increases. So this is some kind of exponential rarefaction which holds in particular for the set of maximal curves. Since the set MD of maximal curves is included in this set MDA, this exponential rarefaction holds in particular for these maximal curves. So these maximal curves which are involved in Hilbert 16's problem and actually occupy a size which is of exponentially decreasing volume as D increases. Okay, now what is not clear yet in this statement is for which volume form I compute this volume. Because MD or MAD is an open subset of the linear system of divisor, which is a real projective space, but yet there is no Fubini-Study volume form on this real projective space. So I need for the statement to be clear to tell you what is this volume form for which we compute the volume, right? So let me do this right now. So I need to put a volume form on this real projective space, since there is no canonical Fubini-Study volume form. Actually, to recall that this linear system of divisor is just the projective space made out of the real section of the bundle L to the power D, which is a real vector space. So to put a volume form on this projective space is the same basically as putting a scalar product on the vector space of section. Once you have a scalar product on this real vector space, it induces a Fubini-Study volume form on the associated projective space. And to induce such a scalar product, this is what you are doing. So we are doing something very standard in Keller geometry. So we equip the ample line bundle L with some Hermitian, real Hermitian metric. So some Hermitian metric which is invariant by this real structure. And this real, we put a real Hermitian metric with positive curvature. Since the bundle is ample, this exists. So I recall that this curvature form omega is then a Keller form. And it is defined as 1 over 2 pi I times dd bar log of h sigma sigma. So this is a local formula. So what is the Keller form near a point x? Well, take a local section sigma around x. Then you can compute the norm square for the metric h. This is h sigma sigma. It is a positive number. So log of this norm square is just a function, a local function on x. And I can compute dd bar of it, where d is just the complex linear part of the exterior derivative, and d bar the complex anti-linear part of the exterior derivative. So dd bar of this function is just indeed two form, which is here a Keller form. This is the condition to have positive curvature. So know that I equip with this L with this Hermitian metric H, I actually have a Keller form omega on my projective surface. So that's what I'm saying here. So first of all, this Hermitian metric induces a Hermitian metric HD on all tensor power L to the power D for every degree. Now, second, since I have this scalar form, it induces a volume form on the surface X, which is just omega square. But I normalize this so that volume is 1. So I divide by the volume. And now comes the scalar product on the vector space of sections, real section of the bundle L to the power D. This is just the L2 scalar product for this Hermitian metric, which is defined by the formula. Take two sections, sigma and tau, and associate to this the integral over X of the scalar product of sigma and tau for this Hermitian metric HD. This is the L2 scalar product. And now, the vector space of section of real section of the bundle becomes an Euclidean space. And since it is an Euclidean space, there is an induced Fubini-Study volume form on the associated projective space, which is the linear system of real divisor. And this is for this Fubini-Study volume form that we compute volume in our theorem with Damien Gaillet. So at this point, the statement is, I hope, clear. Now, before discussing the proof of this theorem, I just would like to make two comments. So the first comment is, try to tell you why this volume form is very natural from a geometric point of view. And this is the first remark that I would like to make. And it is that, well, choosing a Fubini-Study volume form on this real projective space, which is the same as putting a scalar product on the vector space of real section, is actually basically equivalent to choosing a real projective embedding of the projective surface X in this big projective space, where nd is the dimension of the vector space. Because if you have a scalar product on the space of section, well, you may just take an orthonormal basis for this scalar product, and this orthonormal basis become the coordinates of my projective embedding phi d. And now if you choose another orthonormal basis, this has just the effect of composing my embedding with a real isometry, right? So, and conversely, if you have such an embedding, you can take coordinates, which are sections of the bundle L to the power D, and just declare that these sections are an orthonormal basis, and this gives you a scalar product. Now, what is nice with our choice is that from a theorem, actually, the thesis of Gantian, this choice of L2 scalar product is such that this projective embedding is actually asymptotically an isometry. So you cannot manage that such a projective embedding is an isometry, because omega is just any Keller form, and the Keller form arising for such projective embeddings are quite special. These are kind of algebraic ones. But you can do this, manage that this holds asymptotically. So asymptotically, if you pull back the Fubini-Study Keller form or Fubini-Study metric of the projective space by phi d, it converges to the Keller form omega or induced Keller metric on X. So asymptotically, this is an isometry. And so this is why sort of this is a natural choice to put the L2 scalar product on this real linear system of divisor. Now, a second remark which I would like to do is the following. So remember that I, in the theorem, I said that the volume of my set MAD, which depending also of the constant A, is exponentially decreasing. But what you actually prove is more general. So if you now look at MAD, but with the constant A depending on D, so instead of taking a fixed constant, for instance, take A of D equals log of D, then it is bounded from above by C1 times A of D to the power 4 exponential minus C2D over A of D. So this means that you sort of understand all the constants C1 and C2 in the previous theorem depend on A, on this constant A. They of course depend on this constant A, but this theorem tells you a bit how it depends, because knowing this new formulation, C1 and C2 are just true constants. They do not depend on A, they do not depend on, they depend on the sequence, choice of a sequence, but say, choose A of D equal log of D, these are true constants. Okay? So I don't know if you have questions, and if I can hear them or what, but, but okay, in both cases, so so I may start the proof of this theorem, so tell you the proof. So for the proof of this theorem, there are two, say, ingredients. The first ingredient is just some kind of undergraduate probability theory, so we'll just start with this, recall this undergraduate probability result or way of thinking. And then the key tool is the theory of close positive currents, which is familiar to people in Keller geometry or in complex analysis. And we are using some of this theory of close positive currents. So this will be the main ingredient of the proof. But let me first start with this undergraduate probability. And this is known as Markov's inequality or Markov's tricks. Okay. So let's start. So let's consider some probability space PD. So PD for us will be this real projective space at the end of the day. So it will be this linear system, complete linear system of real divisor. So that's why I already put a D denoted by PD to prepare you that it is going to be depending on D, sort of. So now consider random variable on this probability space. That is to say, just a measurable function with value, real valued measurable function. So the first thing people do in probability is to compute the expectation of this random variable. That is just the average value, which I denote by A. So you just integrate F over this probability space PD, which has volume 1. So this just tells you what is the average value of F. And now, the second thing they do in probability is to compute the variance. And if you can do more, you can even, to do more than the variance, you can compute all the, what are called the moments or Markov moments of the function. So Markov moments, which I denote by mk of f, is just the integral of this difference, f minus a to the power k. So f is the random variable, a is the average value of f. So you see that if you can prove that such a moment, k equals 2 corresponds to the variance. So for k equals 2, this m2 is just the variance of the random variable. But okay. So you see that if you can prove that this is small, these Markov moments are small, or even one, say the variance is small, then still the random variable can take values far from the average value A, but if it does this, it can only do this in a set of small measures. It can only take values far from the average value in a set of small measures. And this is the content, this is known as Markov's inequality for the variance. And for this moment, this is, I think, Markov's trick, so let me put it in a lemma. So assume, the aim for me, to give you the proof of this theorem, I want first to tell you where does this exponential decay come from. So remember that in the theorem, I have some exponential decay. So the first thing I want to to show you is how to get some exponential decays. And this is what people in probability tells to you. If you can find the Markov moments for some random variable, then they well know that it produces for you some exponential decay. So I want to first show you the standard trick of probability. And this is the lemma. So assume that for every case, so you can bound from above this Markov moment. So this is just some integral. So you have to bound from above some integral if it's possible for you. So assume that this lower, this upper bound is some constant C times K factorial. And I put this because this is precisely what we are able to prove with Damien Gaillet. So at the, this is exactly the upper bound we get. Then the measure of the set of C in this probability space such that the function random variable f of C minus A is bigger than epsilon of D, where say epsilon is going to be 1, so it's, and I still I put this D to show the dependence with respect to D, is bounded from above by 2C times this exponential minus D. So you see some exponentially small or exponentially decreasing size. And this is just, you'll see a stupid lemma actually, but extremely efficient. And that's why they call this Markov's inequality in probability, because it's really extremely efficient trick. Okay, so I'm going to prove this, so, but so let's again, so I hope statement is clear. So you see I'm looking at the set of say curve, because it's going to be curve for me, C, divisor C, so that the random variable takes value say far from the average A. And since I'm looking at curves, at element C, for which this random value take value far from the average, it has small volume, and actually exponentially small volume measure, because I have this estimation of all the Markov moments. So is this clear for everybody, the statement of the lemma? Yes? So then let me give you the proof of this. So once more, this is just undergraduate probability. So you'll see proof is just a trick. So you notice that for every positive lambda, declaring that the value f of c minus the average value is greater than epsilon d is just completely equivalent to saying that exponential times lambda this absolute value is greater than exponential times lambda epsilon d. Just because lambda is positive, so it doesn't change the inequality, and because exponential is an increasing function, so it doesn't change the inequality as well. So now what you can do with the exponential is to take the infinite series, which defines it. It's some k equals 0 to infinity of lambda k to divided by k factorial times this f of c minus a to the power k. And now here is the computation. So you just, the measure of my set multiplied by exponential lambda epsilon of d is obviously bounded from above by the integral over the whole linear system of the bigger exponential. Because on the left-hand side, I have the integral over my set of exponential lambda epsilon d, but since exponential lambda epsilon d is less than the other exponential, lambda f of c minus a, and since my set is smaller than the whole linear system of divisor, I have this first upper bound, right? And then the exponential I replace by this infinite series and intervert the series and integral. So I kind of put the integral inside the sum. so that the integral of f of c minus a to the power k is just the Markov moment, which I defined. Now, by hypothesis, I assume that my Markov moment I am able to bound from above by k factorial times c. So at the end, I get this c divided by 1 over lambda. Since the infinite series sum of lambda to the power k is just 1 over 1 minus lambda. So everybody agrees with these three lines of computations. And now you just have to choose lambda equals 1 half, or your favorite lambda, the best one, to get the result. So this is a standard trick in probability. If you can just bound the variance for k equals 2, you get with same extremely simple fact some upper bound which would be quadratically decreasing, so it would be some constant times d square. But here I assume that I can do much more than bound from above the variance. I assume that I can bound all Markov moments, all these moments. And if you can do bound all these moments, then instead of some quadratically decreasing measure, you get some exponentially decreasing measure. Get much more since you can do much more. But this is just the trick. Okay? So this is where this exponential decrease comes from. Just from this trick in probability. Now I have to tell you what is going to be my random variable f. So I already said that the probability space is going to be the complete linear system of divisor. But the random variable won't be B0, which gives you the number of real connected components, because for this you cannot compute anything. It is going to be the current of integration. It will be some auxiliary random variable. So proof is not direct. This is why it's not so easy. So it is an indirect proof. So now I will define for you some auxiliary random variable, which comes from the theory of closed positive currents. And this is the subject. So what is a closed positive current of type 1-1? Again, something classical in Keller geometry. But I denote by Z11 L square the set of closed positive currents of type 1-1 and mass L square, which is the integral over X of omega square, or the self-intersection of a divisor linearly equivalent to L. So what is this? Well, a current T in this set is by definition a continuous linear form on the set of two forms, smooth two forms, omega 2 of x. So I denote by omega 2 of x the set of smooth two forms, but not necessarily closed, just every smooth two forms. This is topological vector space. And space of currents is just the dual. The set of continuous linear form. Now, when I say that this current is of type 1-1, it means I assume that this linear form vanishes on forms of type 2-0 and 0-2. And when I'm saying that it is closed, I'm saying in addition that it vanishes on exact two forms. So that's why at the end it vanishes on form of type 2-0, 0-2, and also on the image of one form by the exterior derivative D. So at this point, it is a closed positive current of type 1-1. No, it is a closed current of type 1-1. It becomes a positive current when you assume that against a positive form, it takes positive values. Where a two-form is declared to be positive if it is positive on complex lines. So complex lines are oriented to planes. So in every tangent bundle, you consider a complex line. It is an oriented two planes you can restrict the two form on this. It is a multiple of the volume form for this oriented plane, and you want this to be a positive multiple. So if you have this positivity condition, you have closed positive currents. And its mass is just the value against the Keller form omega, which I declare to be L square, this number. So now a trick is that for positive currents, they are actually measure-like currents. So a general current is a linear form on omega 2, but omega 2 with the C-infinity topology. But actually, for when the current is positive, you can bound its value against a two-form by the C0 norm of the two-form, and not the C-infinity. So the C-infinity norm is bounded by the C0 norm for positive currents. And this implies that actually the set of closed positive currents of mass L-square is just a compact and convex space for the same reason as the set of probability measure in some space is compact and convex for the weak star topology. This is Ries' theorem. Right? So this is very nice because you have a compact and convex space in which you can see all your divisors for every degree D. So if you take a divisor C, linearly equivalent to the variample bundle L to the power D, you can associate to this divisor the normalized current of integration, which is take a two-form phi and integrate this two-form phi over the curve C. So this, if I would just do this, the mass would go to infinity, but I just renormalize by dividing by D. And then I have a current, which is called the current of integration, or normalized current of integration, associated to every divisor C. And I denote by Z this map, which sends such a divisor C to the current of closed positive currents of integration ZC. So you see that you have this compact and convex space, of course, kind of infinite dimensional, which contains all linear system of divisor. Okay. Now, what we can do is a proposition, and let me comment that it's a proposition à la Schiffman and Zeldich, since Bernard Schiffman and Steve Zeldich quite work a lot over the complex number to figure out the probability of this kind of random variable made of current of integration. So we are just kind of using their techniques, and this proposition is kind of very much in the spirit of their work. So for every two-form phi with compact support in the complement of the real locus, in the complex locus of the manifold, well, the expectation of this random variable, which takes a curve C and associates its current of integration against phi, converges as D goes to infinity to the Keller form omega. That means, of course, if you take a real curve C and consider the normalized current of integration over this C, you have something which is very different from a Keller form, which also defines a current by wedge product. Take the integral over x of omega wedge phi. This is the current omega against phi. If you take just current of integration over a curve, it's very much different from this. But if you average this current of integration for all curves in your real linear system of divisor, you obtain something which becomes very close to a Keller form, and asymptotically, it is exactly the Keller form. Over the complex number, it would be the pullback. Let's say it's just the Keller form asymptotically. This is the first thing. And moreover, we can compute all the Markov moments for this random variable. So z against phi is my random variable. Omega against phi is asymptotically my the average value, the expectation. So I'm exactly in the previous situation. RLD is my complete linear system of divisor, which is my probability space. So the second part of the proposition is just the Markov moment for my random variable. And I can bound it from above by some constant time k factorial, where the constant just depends on the support of phi. Okay? So now you see that the first step of the proof was this probability trick. Now you see that using this theory of current of integration, I can use it. I have some random variable, which is the current of integration. And for this current of integration, it turns out I am able to compute these integrals. First of all, the expectation, which is already an integral to compute. Second, the variance and all Markov moments are integral to compute, which I can compute for this random variable, the current of integration. But I would not be able to compute this for just the first one, topological one, which is the number of connected components of the real locus. And how come I can compute this integral? Well, this comes from the Poincaré-Lelong's formula, which tells you that 1 over 2 pi I d times dd bar log of hd sigma sigma is just omega minus this normalized current of integration. Where here sigma denotes just a real holomorphic section, where I should say non-vanishing, different from the zero section, and c is the vanishing locus of sigma, so it's a curve. And you see here it's no more a local formula, it's global at every point. So if you look at a point x where sigma of x doesn't vanish, then of course x is not on the curve c, which is the vanishing locus. So the term zc, which is the current of integration over c, just vanishes because it has support on c. And then you just recover the previous formula which computes the curvature of the bundle L to the power D. So you see away from the vanishing locus of sigma, the second term ZC is zero, and you just compute the curvature. But this formula is also valid at vanishing point, and you see that you, from in the sense of currents, what you should correct, you correct the curvature form by the current of integration, ZC. And you see that thanks to this Poincaré-Lelong formula, on the right-hand side, you see the current of integration, ZC. While on the left-hand side, you have something which you can put in an integral and compute. Because if you put you fix some orthonormal bases for the set of sections, this vector space of section, choose an orthonormal basis, then you have coefficients. And on the right-hand side, you see that sigma is just a linear combination of the basis with some coefficients. And you just integrate on the coefficients. Then you can compute. So the miracle that we can compute currents of integration, which looks geometric objects, and you don't understand how you will put them in an integral. The miracle is this Poincaré-Lelong formula, which gives you some formula, which you can put in an integral. So this Poincaré-Lelong formula puts you this in an integral, and then you have to compute. So I don't give you the computation. I just want to give you the main idea, not the computation. Well, our paper is on the archive anyway, so. Okay, so this is the first part, or the second. So from this, you see we have a random variable, the current of integration, and we are able to do all computation to apply the probability trick, Markov's trick. But how to relate this random variable with the topology of the real locus, the number of connected components? And for this, we are using the theory of weakly laminar currents, which appeared in the theory of complex dynamical system. So it was introduced by Bedford, Lubitsch, and Smiley in the 90s, and motivation arose from complex dynamical systems. So this is a notion familiar to people working in complex dynamical systems. Now you declare that a current T is weakly laminar if and only if there is a family of embedded disks, DA, such that if you take two such disks, their intersection is open in DA and DA prime. So they just two different disks are either disjoint or they kind of intersect in an open subset. And the current T is the integral over A, which is assumed to be a measure space, times the integral over the disk. So if you take a two-form phi, T against phi, is just you first integrate phi over the disk, and then integrate over A. So of course, the current of integration is such a weakly laminar current. You should think of this a bit as current of integration over a lamination with transverse measure. And so for example, every current of integration is weakly laminar, while on the contrary, a Keller form omega is nowhere weakly laminar, so it's something different at the opposite of being weakly laminar. So this current of integration R, or once more, you think of a lamination with transverse measure, this is a weakly laminar current. So. So now I want to formulate another result. So we denote by ZA the closure in the set of positive current, this compact and convex space of positive current with fixed mass L square, of the union over all degree of my set MDA. So remember that MDA is the set of roughly maximal curves, so this is an open subset of my linear system of real divisor. So, and the map Z was the map which to every divisor C associate the current of integration over Z. So thanks to this map, I said, every linear system of divisor sits in the set of positive currents. So in particular, my open subset MDA, which I want to prove exponential, they have exponentially small volume. So in particular, these ones I can send by Z, this map, in the set of closed positive currents. These are just normalized current of integration over my roughly maximal curves. So they sit in the set of closed positive currents, and I take the closure. So ZA now is the closure. It's a compact set, which contains all currents which are adherent in the closure, a limit of a sequence of, say, maximal curves. And with Damien Gaillet, we prove the following nice result, that if you take any current T in this closure, the restriction of T to the complement of the real locus turns out to be weakly laminar. So this is a geometric property of real maximal curves. If you take any sequence of real maximal curves, where as D increases, say, and you take any current, which is the limit of this sequence of maximal curves. So this sequence of maximal curve, you can view this as a sequence of current of integration. And you take a current T, which is the limit. Then T is weakly laminar. And this is a geometric property. Well, of course, it's easy to build a sequence which would converge to omega. And rather, I would say a typical, since expectation of the current of integration is omega, a typical, at random, such a sequence would rather converge to omega. So this theorem tells you that these are really special currents, the one arising from maximal curves or curves with many, many real components, a big number of. So So I recall here the statements, the same statement, and I just comment the proof. The, for this theorem, you actually did nothing, basically. It's just a direct corollary of a theorem of Henri de Tellin, who is working in France, in Paris. And his theorem concerns current of integration in the unit ball of C squared. And the result relies actually on the fact that if you take a maximal curve C, or a curve C in this set MDA, which has a huge number of real components, then the restriction of C to the complement has actually small genus. The genus of the curve away from the real locus is actually bounded from above by A times D, so it's linear with respect to D. And the theorem of Henri de Tellin roughly tells you that if you take a sequence of embedded curves in the unit ball such that the genus is small, less than is a big O of its area, so basically linear with respect to D, then any currents adherent to this is weakly laminar. So we can just use this theorem once we know that for maximal curve, the genus is small. Well, for maximal curve, genus is even zero away from the real locus. Okay, so this is the proof. We just first observe that genus is small away from the real locus, and then apply this theorem of Henri de Tellin, which tells you that then it can only converge to some weakly laminar currents. Okay, and now I'm ready to prove the main result. So from this theorem, we know first of all ZA is compact, since it was the closure of all these curves, and it doesn't contain the expectation omega. This we know from the theorem I just mentioned. Since any current in ZA has to be weakly laminar, away from the real locus. In particular, it can't be the Keller form omega, which, remember, was the asymptotically the expectation of the random variable. So now I'm in a situation familiar to probabilists once more. So I have a random variable. I know its expectation, it is omega. And now I'm interested in an open subset which lies in a compact subset far from omega, well, disjoint from omega. It's a compact set disjoint from omega. So then there exists a finite number of two-form phi j with support in the complement x minus rx, where j is in some finite set j, so that for every current t in this compact set ZA, there is some j such that t minus omega against phi j is greater than 1. This is obvious. This is true for every current in ZA. There exists some form phi. Since it is not omega, there is some form phi such that it's greater than 1. Just multiply phi by a sufficiently high scalar. And now, since my set is compact, from this form you get at every point, you can extract a finite cover. And that's why at the end I get a finite number of two-form phi j with this property. And now I can apply my proposition à la Schiffmann-Zeldich. From this proposition, which bounds all Markov moments, I deduce from this trick in probability that the set of curves C, so that the current of integration minus omega against phi j is greater than 1, has an exponentially decreasing volume. Because, well, this is the trick in probability. I can bound all Markov moments. So zc minus omega is my random variable. So this random variable takes value far from the average value, which is omega, in a set of exponentially decreasing volume. And that's the end, because I have one set for every j, one set of exponentially decreasing volume. And since I have finitely many j, I take finite union of this set, it still has exponentially decreasing volume. But the finite union of this set contains my compact set MA, and then contains all these set of maximal curves MD or MAD. So this is the end of the proof. Okay, thank you very much.